We don't take an offering or anything like that, but this box up here is just for sowing into whatever God is putting on your heart. Okay, so find me. I have the mic if you have a word. Thanks, guys.
Yes. lots of opportunity for celebration. God is a celebrator and he loves a party. So he's given us the Sabbath that we are to have a weekly celebration to rest and enjoy his goodness. And then we have Rosh Chodesh. I will get that. And that's a monthly celebration with God. And that's when we celebrate first fruits. And then we have feasts throughout the year to meet with God and to allow him to do something special in our lives. And the bottom line is just that he wants to celebrate with us. He is a God of celebration. He loves a party. Thanks, Lair. So there's party horns over there that we're going to do as part of the first fruits. So when we do first fruits offering, you can take a party horn. So Larry took his early. If you want to take yours early, you can. I refer to you as the peanut gallery if you continue to do that. Okay, so let's see if I can get this. There we go. So first fruits honors God as our source. He is our provider, and when we give first fruits, it is a declaration that God has blessed us. It sanctifies the rest of the harvest, and it brings blessing. Romans 11:16 says, if the part of the dough offered at first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. And that's a beautiful picture of what that means for first fruits and for giving a portion to God. So Ezekiel 44:30 says, give the first portion so a blessing may rest on your household. And Proverbs 3:9-10, honor the Lord with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats will brim over with new wine. And we always want to pay attention to when it, wherever it says then, right? Then, you know, we do something and then this happens. It's a byproduct of our faithfulness to God is that it just opens the door of blessing when we're obedient to him and when we just share with him what he's already given us. And so, you know, we all know the story of Cain and Abel. And when I saw that picture, first fruits giving our best, not our leftovers, you know, I'm sure you heard teaching on that Cain probably didn't give God his best, and that's why it was displeasing to the Lord. And you look at that apple, and then you look at the kind of the shrivelly thing that it went down to, and, you know, you can just imagine that maybe, you know, Cain was going through his crop going, oh, well, I'll give God this one, and I'll give that one. And these are all really good. I'll keep these. And it was like, That's just not, that just, I'm sure that saddened the heart of the Lord, but that Abel brought the first of his flock. And so we wanna focus in on, well, what is that first? So why should Christians celebrate Rosh Chodesh or first fruits? You know, until we started coming to KEC, we really didn't know much about, you know, I didn't know much about my Jewish roots as a Christian believer. I'm grafted in, and as a Christian believer, you each are grafted in. So you have the full blessing of being a Jew and a Christian. And so it's important for us to understand these things that God set up for all of us. So Isaiah 66:23, it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. It's not just for the Jews. So the new moon is first fruits. It's Rosh Chodesh. It gives us an opportunity to honor, praise, and thank God for what he has done in the previous month. So it's about looking back on the previous month, but it's also a time to step out in faith for the month to come, by bringing an offering to him at the beginning and not the end. It is a time to worship him, inquire of him about the month ahead, and feast with him. So it is meant to be a celebration. By giving him the first, we sanctify the whole month, just as that verse I had shared before, and we are positioned to receive his blessing. So again, it's an opportunity to give God our best. So God promises an outpouring of blessing if we do it, and there are three ways to give to God. We have the first fruits, which is honoring God, and that's at the beginning. We have a tithe, and this is obedience to God. And then we have contributions, which are voluntary expressions of thanksgiving to God. Different ways to give, different times to give. At first fruits, how much do you give? You know, a lot of people get really worked up about, oh my gosh, I have to give God this, you know, and it's like, first of all, it's all his anyway. And at first fruits, it's a portion. So the Bible says a portion. And we know that this isn't 10%. The tithe was 10%. And the tithe was after the harvest was, the full harvest was collected. That's when the 10% was accounted for and given. This is the first fruit, so you don't know how big your harvest is going to be. So you don't know how much to actually give. You just choose a portion, and there's complete freedom in that. For the barley harvest, it looks from the research, it looks like it was about 2 sheaves, which isn't a lot. For the grape harvest, it was probably just a basket of fruit. I mean, think about how many vineyards you see everywhere and how much fruit can be harvested. But a basket of fruit was what was given, and it was those first fruits that started to appear on the vine, the best ones at the beginning. So you decide. There's no legalism. There's no legalism with first fruits. It's really Amen. About you stepping out in faith and giving something that you've determined in your heart to give. So God's calendar. I love this graphic because it just feels a really good, gives you the year in view. So Nisan 1 is really the new year. It's Moses. It's the new year that God gave to Moses when he told him, you know, this is what's going to happen, the people are going to leave Egypt, and he set forth a calendar to Moses. And then down below, it starts with Tishri, with Yom Kippur, that's more like the civil new year. And so so there are two new years that the Jews celebrate, but this is the one that was given to Moses, is what we celebrate right now at Nisan. And it was kind of cool. One of the things that, it's on my slide or not, it might be when I cut, but I'm going to share it anyway because I thought it was kind of cool. It's just that when we look at a Jewish day, it begins at sunset. There's a little bit of activity at sunset, and then there's darkness, and we sleep, and it's quiet. And then at sunrise, activity begins again. And so it's kind of cool to look at this. There's some activity here, and then we go into the harvest time, and at the civil new year, there's a few things that happen, but then it's pretty quiet. And Hanukkah is kind of a later tradition for the Jews, but it's pretty quiet until we get to Nisan 1 again, you know? And so then there's a lot of activity again. So anyway, it's just neat how God has laid out his timetable.
Amen.
So we've got spring, Passover, redemption, redeemed by the blood, and cleansing, cleansed from the impurity. And we can see next week we're going to be doing a Seder, and so we're going to be going over all that Passover meant and how it all pointed to Jesus. And so we have that redemption and the cleansing from impurity. And then in the early summer we've got Pentecost and the provision, the wheat harvest, was in the natural, and the law was given in the old covenant, and then in the spirit, the new covenant was given during this time in early summer. And then in fall is the Feast of Tabernacles, with God tabernacling with his people, and that's when they saw his glory. And Jesus was most likely born during the Feast of Tabernacles, is what they believe. God with us, Emmanuel, during the Feast of Tabernacles. How perfect is that, right? God's timing. So as we move into understanding the month of Nisan, it is the first month, and its root word is Nisim, which means miracles.
Amen.
Nisan is a month to expect miracles. It also means redemption. Jesus redeemed us in Nisan at Passover by being our Passover lamb. His blood saved us. And the Jews also call Nisan the month of Aviv. Aviv means springtime. So we've come through a winter season, and it's time for life to break forth. Another Hebrew word for Nisan is teshuva, and that word means repentance. So springtime is a picture of repentance as well. Repentance is turning away from a cold, dead season and moving into a season of life. So Aviv, or Nisan, is a month to be cleansed from anything that held you back in an old season, so you are free to move forward in God's blessing. How many people want to move forward?
Amen.
Amen. All right. So the first Sunday after Passover. So we're celebrating first fruits now, but the first fruits is for the new year is actually the first Sunday after Passover. So that's when the barley harvest is, and that's the first of the first. And this first fruit guaranteed all the harvest for the rest of the year, wheat, grapes, and olives. And that God chose for one of the greatest events in history, when Jesus was the first fruit and raised from the dead. Isn't that just beautiful, you guys? So excited about that. So Nisan is the first month in the yearly cycle of feasts. It's the beginning month. It is the month of the barley harvest. It is the month God called his people out of Egypt. It is the month associated with the tribe of Judah. And Judah was always the first tribe. When the Israelites marched through the wilderness, Judah went first. In battle, Judah went first. So this first month is the Judah month. So as we learn about Judah, we understand Nisan. Judah is the kingly tribe, the tribe of the Messiah. Judah is the tribe of praise. And Judah's symbol is the lion. That's a painting that our daughter had done. So our daughter is, yeah, she's 18, almost 19. Judah comes from the root word yada. And yada means hand. Yada means to extend the hand. And it came to me to praise God with lifted hands. And how many of us do that? How many of us praise our, you know, we praise the Lord with lifted hands? And in Hebrew, the hand is a symbol of power and strength. The hand is a symbol of lifting up hands to God is giving God your strength and abilities and putting yourself in his hands. Praise is important this month. So this month of Nisan is about praise, and Judah means praise. Judah also means to extend the hand in battle and to use a weapon to defeat the enemy. Judah is the tribe of war. So praise and warfare are connected in the Bible. How many of you know that it brings down the strongholds of the enemy when we praise our God? Psalm 149:6, may the praise of God be in their mouths and a double-edged sword in their hands. And who is the double-edged sword? Jesus, the Word. So praising God is an act of war. When you praise God, you are driving back the enemy. So be prepared to stand against the enemy in God's power. The power of Egypt was overthrown in Nisan, and God's people were set free. Amen. Prophetically, that's the month we are in, and all of us have those battles, but the battle belongs to the Lord.
So we can praise him.
So Rosh Chodesh and Nisan is a wow. And I love this picture of the lion and the lamb and the cross and the sun and the light. So it's a picture of what God has done for us, giving us his only son, his firstborn of a new creation. It depicts the reality of a new beginning in Jesus. The moon disappears at the end of the month in darkness and then emerges as a new moon. We are new creations in Christ. Nisan, the month of Judah, the lion, and the lion is the tribe of Judah. He bought our redemption by his blood as the Passover Lamb of God. He was raised on the Feast of First Fruits, which is the Sunday after Passover, and he was a first fruit offering, and all of God's blessings were released to us at that moment because of him. Amen. And so when the first fruit is given and the first fruit makes the rest of it holy, Jesus made us all holy.
Amen.
So we're going to go back into worship now. And we're going to praise him. We're going to raise our hands. And if you want to give a first fruits offering, and the box is over there. And whether you choose to give or not, please take a horn and blow it during worship. and just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And enjoy this first fruit celebration. And we hope you can all come to the Seder next week as well. That's going to be really cool. So, God bless you guys.
So I'm going to go ahead and encourage you guys to go ahead and come on up. And if you have an offering, you can put it in. But make sure you grab a horn so you have it during worship. And I don't know what we have up next for worship, but let's go into celebration where we can blow the horns. Amen? All right. Lord, bring your power and your authority down in Jesus' name. So I again, come on up and get a horn and let's worship.
Thank you.
place he calls us to. We come into it obediently. So Father, we thank you for the blessings. We thank you for the anointings. We thank you for the callings. We thank you for the ability to celebrate. Can I hear a shout from the Lord?
Prophetic art and prophetic jewelry. And I messaged her and I said, gosh, I would love to have some of your pieces up at my retreat. And then she wrote back to me and she said, well, why not just come? And so we have become very fast and famous friends. And she is an absolute delight and steals my heart. And I know she's going to steal yours. She's from Southern California. She lives near Hollywood. And with her two sons who are at UCLA and her husband. And so anyway, I'm just going to give the microphone to her. You're just going to fall in love with her as much as I have. Melvina.
And I love her. Thank you. Thank you, Gil. Thank you for all of you and your warm welcome. Thank you, Tammy, for being involved. She's a connector. She spends... Oh, thank you. I keep dropping my cap. I hope that's not prophetic. Yeah. I'll get my act together here. No, it's okay. It's okay. Let it. We'll make it work. So the lights. I'm blinded by the light. It's like a heaven moment. Whoa! It's out the tunnel. Thank you, Lord. That was awesome. I do follow the Hebraic calendar. I live by it. I am associated with Chuck Pierce, if you guys have heard of him. My house is the house of Zion, as they call it. It's the house of one. It's just me. There is not a lot of people out there. And when I moved to LA, I was looking for a house of Zion. But unfortunately, it's non-existent in that region. So I became the one and only. I also have a business, as you mentioned, and prophetic jewelry and all that kind of stuff. And I am a business of Zion, so I am associated with them in more than one form. it's a huge church, very prophetic, and I know they do follow very religiously the Hebraic calendar. So I don't move unless the Hebraic calendar moves.
Amen.
You got to be in the timing of the Lord. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about you need to know God's cycles. Because sometimes we're waiting for the promise, but a promise out of timing is not a promise. I don't care how much money you got, if it's not when God wanted you to have it, not going to work. So, I'm not going to preach on that. But the reason why I'm here, I love Southern California. I've lived there for a long, long time. Originally, I lived in San Diego, and 3 years ago, the Lord, by faith, moved us to LA. Now, if you want to know what faith, kind of faith you have, you go to LA. Where I live is the little Jerusalem. Half is Jewish, half is Muslim. There is no church. There is no place of worship. You're it. Okay, so it's a very small town. A lot of students, and they don't know where to go to worship. Very orphan, and I'll explain why I'm sharing this, because it doesn't make a lot of sense. I mean, you guys, if you've been in LA on vacation, you kind of know what it feels like. A lot of homeless. I'm not in the downtown LA area. I am in what they call West LA or West Hollywood. You know, my children are musicians, so I love Judah. I live for Judah. I do believe that creativity will be the weapon we're going to use in end times to defeat the enemy. Zechariah 1:18. Yes. There will be four horns. You're going to look at the vision in chapter 1 of Zechariah. Four horns, four powers that are coming, and in the vision, Zechariah sees four craftsmen. And if you look at the Hebrew language, they're craftsmen. They're nothing scientific or religious or holy. They're just craftsmen. I think it's the wisdom of God that's going to come creatively to be able. I hear something vibrate. Is that the snare?
Yes.
Okay, good. I like that. Frequency. It moves. Okay. So, I do believe that creativity is that thing that's going to allow us to penetrate a world that doesn't want Christianity. But if you're creative enough, I have to be very creative in Hollywood. I really have. Because how do you preach in Beverly Hills when they think they have heaven? They have it all. They have more money than God. Or something like that. So you can't go preach that my Christianity is going to improve your life. It's not going to work. So I live there. My children are musicians. And the Lord brought us there. And it's kind of like a Noah anointing, you know? It's the four of us in a house. Nobody else. So, you know, you gotta go outside and work it. But when Azusa was announced, Azusa Now, I was so excited because it's my town and I want revival so bad. I've been praying for it for a very long time in Southern California. But the Lord told me, no, you can't go to Azusa. And that sounds like counterintuitive. Because it's my town, really. It's all for me. But when I pray about it, the Lord said, no, you're not going to Azusa. And I'm like, it's first fruits. I gotta go. That's my first fruit, my kids. We gotta be there and worship. I mean, be in the ground. I need to touch it. I need the glory. I'm like, I gotta be there. And all of a sudden, the Lord said, no, we're gonna go to Sacramento. I said, okay, that doesn't make any sense. They're all coming down here. By the way, a lot of these ladies that I'm hanging out with, and we're registered. We're going. Oh, they have planned a drive down, and we're going to eat somewhere, and this is the hotel we want. And I'm like, everybody's coming down here. I'm going to go there by myself. It doesn't make any sense. Well, I continue to pray, and then the Lord, I want to stand here with the lights. I like to see people's
the lights are on so we can film. If you're not in the
room,
then we
can't.
Yeah, without the lights.
I'll make it work. Well, that way
the first part will be in the dark.
That's okay. We'll make it work. Because the anointing works, we can without lights. Thank you. So, when I started praying about it, the Lord brought me back to 2008. And some of you have heard me say this already, so I apologize for the repetition. 2008 was a time where the Southern California Church in San Diego, is where I live then, gathered to cry out to the Lord to have Proposition 8 be placed in the ballot so we could vote against same-sex marriage. That was 2008. And Lou Engel, who is the same gentleman who did the, who's doing Azusa Now, was the same gentleman who put the call, is what he called it, in San Diego. And that was a large gathering. Every denomination, every group, every crowd came. And oh my goodness, it was glorious to watch the church come and worship, calling out to God, repenting. And we won. We put it in the ballot, the majority voted. We were like, whoa, this is amazing. And then it came to Sacramento. And then the court ruled. I mean, there were a lot of lawsuits. It's a long story. I'm simplifying the story, by the way, so don't go cheap, you know. It came to the courts. It upheld the first thing. But when you went to the Supreme Court with all the lawsuits, we were not good. And now it's legal in 16 other states. So as I was praying, the Lord brought me back and said, why are you bringing me back to 2008? And the Lord said, well, the people gathered, but the rules, the courts overruled you. So, because we thought we had failed. I mean, I even met Lou. Lou is, by the way, there's a house of prayer in Hollywood. A lot of young people, Radiance International, now they have one in Times Square. So it's a lot of young people, but they're all orphans, no parents, no older generation. So you have all these young, creative people without parents. No. Lou is the daddy. So Lou was the one who, you know, I remember seeing him at the house of prayer, and he said, I know you, because, you know, I was part of his prayer, the prayer team that was behind the scene. But he sees so many people. And I know you. I'm like, oh, yeah, I was in San Diego praying. Remember, Prophet? And he's like, oh. We all kind of have these memories of, wow, that was so painful. You know, because we fasted and prayed and strived. Have you done that? I mean, we've been praying for years for California, for the water issue, for so many things. There are so many intercessors in this state. I mean, this is a state based on prayer. But we see a little. From time to time, we get all excited. It's like an Alka-Seltzer. And it does. Okay? So I cried out to the Lord. I need to understand, what did we do different? What do we need to do different? Okay? And I moved to LA, and then now I'm by myself, so it's okay. The kids excite me at the house of prayer, so I keep praying there. And all of a sudden, this jubilee is coming. I mean, I won my restoration of everything that the enemy has stolen. He's stolen a lot from the state. He gave me the scripture that I quoted when I came to the mic earlier. Isaiah 42:22. We are a people that have been plundered, that have been robbed. And the Lord asked, who is going to say restore? Who? I'm saying restore. Yeah. But when I questioned the Lord, okay, you won't let me go to Azusa, so what are we doing with first fruits? He says, go to Sacramento. And I said, well, why? And he showed me a tabernacle. By the way, I only minister, I don't know why, it's the prophetic life. I live in Southern California. I go to a place called Bakersfield, okay? It's a little hole in the wall. I love the people there, it's amazing. And then I come to Sacramento. Why? I don't know. It's God's plan for something. But the last time I was in Sacramento, right before this trip, I do a lot of spiritual mapping. I love to know why a region is the way it is. So I gotta find out, okay, why is Bakersfield like this? I mean, it's different, you know? And you're like just 2 hours from LA, but it's like, oh, what happened? So it's different, they're great people. But you look at the land, you look at everything. And the Lord always provides information. You can tell I'm a storyteller, so if I'm boring you, please let me know. But Bakersfield, after I did my little bit of studying, the Lord brought me a gentleman who knows the whole history of Bakersfield. He lived there for 85 years. It was full of stories. Came over and he was so excited and says, look, this love here, they have a huge love, has all these oil rigs, and we pump 560,000 barrels a day of oil. And we've been pumping for years, and there is more oil under to be pumped than we've pumped already. So I was so excited, oh my gosh, 2 Kings 4, the widow with the oil. I'm gonna go get my oil. Okay, God prophetic, everything is prophetic for me. So first thing was watching all these rigs, thousands. I actually have a picture, if you guys wanna see it, it's on my phone. Thousands of these rigs. And it used to be a river that dried out. And the Lord spoke to me, clear as I'm talking to you. Well, he doesn't talk audibly, but he shows me. I'm a seer, so I see everything. And the Lord showed me, it used to be a river, John the Baptist move, a water baptism that has dried out, and now the oil is coming. Okay? So when I continue to research Bakersfield, they're called the oil capital of California. The largest amount of oil is pumped in Bakersfield, whether you know it or not. But they're also called the breadbasket of California because they farm a lot. It's all farming. I mean, it's farmland as far as you can see. And they produce quite a bit of the products that we consume. So I'm sitting in my house going, okay, so what are you showing me? And he showed me California as the tabernacle. And he told me, Southern California is my outer court. You guys gather down there, cry out. The people come and repent. Have you seen the pictures of Azusa?
Yeah.
Whoa, I can't wait to get home. Because I'm going to shower in that anointing as soon as I get home. I mean, it's thousands of people gathering, crying out to God. And there is history in the land. I believe in the land. When I put my feet on the ground, you make an impact. It's holy ground. Yesterday I took my shoes off because I had to touch the ground. So Southern California, the Lord showed me, is an article where we come and we request. Okay? And he's given me many scriptures for this, but for the sake of time, and yet you can throw something at me and tell me, you're done. So that, the Lord showed me, is an outer court. You go to Bakersfield and you are in the holy place with the bread and the oil, the menorah, okay? It is the show bread and the oil and anointing. You've gone from the outer court to the holy place, but now I want you to go to the Holy of Holies, which is Sacramento. In Spanish, Sacramento is a sacred thing. Now, you cannot rule unless you've been in there. Yeah. And he spoke to me out of Zechariah 3, where the high priest didn't look very good. And I'm not going to read the scriptures for the sake of time, so you can research it yourself. I'll paraphrase the Bible. Zechariah 3, Zechariah is having a vision. Joshua, the high priest, doesn't look very good. It's kind of filthy, looking dirty. And guess who's on his right hand? The devil. Have you ever seen Law and Order? Here's the court, the judge. Okay, court is in order now. Over here is the Joshua, the high priest. Not looking good. And who's over here? Satan, accusing. Okay? You know what, you California people? You pray all you, you know, you spend 40 days fasting, praying, look what happened. See, the most liberal state. You're a mess. Look at your kids, they're all screwed up. They're all prodigals. You have no kids. Here's Satan accusing us. Okay? And the Lord says, don't you worry. I'll rebuke Satan. Okay? In that moment, the Lord takes care of Joshua and instructs the angel to dress him properly. Take a clean robe and put my most favorite part, a clean turban. Because it's in our minds. We don't have the right understanding of the nature of God and the courts of God, we're not going to have supernatural lives. I did an act in Bakersfield, prophetic act, where all is a large Hispanic community, gang infested. And the Lord made me do a prophetic act where the older generation had to repent for showing their children a lousy God. It's so lack of power, their children go get power in the gangs. And those parents came to the altar and cried out to God. And after that, they had to go. Their children came and they were all rolling their eyes. I had demons coming out of my ears because they were all rolling their eyes. They didn't want to be there. But the Lord brought them, thank God. And the next part, the Lord says, now these parents have to go and ask forgiveness from their children. Because we cheated our children. We have to. giving our children a lousy deal. Our children don't want to go to church because we're limping away, I don't have any money, I'm depressed, I have problems. That's not God. And Joshua was like that. He didn't look very good. And the Lord says, I'm going to put a new turban. I'm going to put a new mind on you. And then he says, if you keep my ways, if you keep my way, if you obey me, if you serve me, I'm going to let you govern my house and rule in my courts. And the Lord showed me, if go to Sacramento at First Fruit. If I'm the only one who does it, call me crazy. There's a video saying. So at that moment, I realized, okay, where am I supposed to go? And he showed me specific places. There were three places that I was supposed to be at, and this is number three. And what the Lord has shown me is that we need to, and by the way, the places I've been, I haven't had big crowds, because everybody's in Azusa, okay? So, you know, in the mind you go like, but I want everybody to hear it. And God's saying, there's a remnant. Only the high priest went into the Holy of Holies. That was not like, oh, come on together, let's do it. No, it didn't work that way. Very few people have access to the Holy of Holies. Very few people are going to have to rule in the court. Not everybody is going to have that access. So a lot of times we think of revival as this thing where, you know, Azusa was amazing. But I want to see the fruit. Gathering in the rain for one day, not to take away my love, I'm going to get a piece of it. But if it doesn't produce what it's supposed to produce, we need to ask ourselves what happened. We are the people of God. We're the sons and daughters of Almighty God with supernatural power. So if we do not understand the legalities of the courts of heaven, how dare can we decree things when we don't understand what God's saying? I don't know, to me that's the fear of God right there. Man, like what am I praying for? God's not even in it. I have to know what he wants for this state. And I have to add one detail. The only reason why I do this, when I came to this country, I made a decision I was going to become an American. I don't pray for my country. Please, Mom, forgive if you see this tape, nothing against you. But he brought me here to become an American. And I raised my children as American. They don't speak Spanish, Mom gets all upset. But the Lord gave us that assignment to become Americans. I have a heart for this nation, like you would not believe. And I have, my heart melts when I see California. Now I'm falling in love with Sacramento, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't live here. So I come as often as I can. But I'm saying this to say, I want to see the fruit of our prayers. I want to see the power of God manifested in this state. And by the way, as California goes, as Sacramento goes, same way with Prop 8, so goes the nation. Are you hearing me? I want to stir you up. This is about sitting, give me a sermon. No. We are people of power. We have a mighty God. Thank you. Somebody's awake. Yes, we have a mighty, mighty God. If we don't have a place to gather, I don't care. I'll do it with my pajamas in my house by myself. And God better show up. All he needs is one person that says, I'm right here. Come on. You know, I've been in some of the gatherings, nobody's awake. I said, show up just for me. Just for me. Because they're waiting for entertainment. No, that's not the point. Don't put pressure on Judah. It's not their job to get us high. Although they go first. But you know what? The kingdom of God is within you. But do we understand the kingdom of heaven? Do we understand heaven and the nature of heaven? And if you read Revelation, Revelation 5 described the 10,000 and 10,000 angels and all that's going on out there. So if I'm going to the king to rule on my behalf, I better understand what's cooking up there. It is a lot of action. It is not three songs and an offering. It isn't. Nothing against that works. But Some of you that were at the upper room is like, okay, I could stay here.
Yeah.
Okay, you can be there and you don't want to go. Because when he shows up, there's no, I don't even get hungry. You get full. There's no, my physical needs go away somehow. So we need to start understanding that. We need to, and by the way, I do follow the Hebraic year, I said it earlier, and this year is 5776, and you, this house understands that, so I don't have to do a lot of explaining. But it's a Baal year. It's a year of connecting people. Aligning with people. He will be connected. He will be connected. This is a season that's closing, and you're going into a new season. Okay, but in transition, have you ever been in transition? Have you ever tried to birth a baby? Sorry guys, I know you don't do that, but you know what I mean? Have you ever tried? That's not a pleasant situation. It's not clean, it's not pretty, and it's very, very painful. And if the husband has been there, they'll know what that looks like. It's nasty. Okay, so birthing something new is very difficult. It's very painful and it requires a lot of energy. Okay, and that's what we are. We're entering today. We started sundown last night, like Lori explained to us very nicely, by the way. Great job. The Lord follows the moon. He don't follow the sun or New Year like we do. He's following this year. This is his jubilee. So if you're going into that, we need to understand what he's saying. Now, many prophets have had words about 5776. What he showed me, and there is a YouTube video somewhere of me, with the word that he gave me specifically. And he gave me the word three axes. We're going to have three axes to things. I got it, the Dalet here. I have keys everywhere. Keys everywhere. But I ended up with a bunch of keys in my house, and I didn't know what they opened. You know, we were moving, and I had all these keys, and I'm like, I have no idea, I didn't label them, so it's just keys. And the Lord spoke to me, how good is to have keys if you don't know the doors that you're going through? Mm-hmm. And then we had the door here, that let, right, we had doors everywhere. That was 5774. The doors are locked. We knock, knock, nothing's there. And we're still waiting. A lot of us have been waiting for many, many years. This year, the Lord told me it's free access, and I've had visions that I can spend years explaining here. I'm not going to spend the time. But he showed me we will go through double doors that will stay open. So Isaiah 60, if you want to check it. They will continually stay open. There will be transfer of wealth with the free access. Not health for your new Mercedes, by the way. Have wealth for the kingdom.
Yeah.
Wealth that is going to pass through your hands from here to here so that we can do the supernatural things of the kingdom.
Yeah.
People need to go to India and we need cash.
Yeah.
Let's send them to India.
Yes.
Does that make sense? So when he told me about free access, that's what it's starting today. Today is a year of connecting with people, with access, opening doors, favor. You get to meet people that can help you out, or you become the access for them for something else. Okay? As a body, it's my ministry, it's my church, it's my thing. That has to end. We are a body, and we need each other. And we need Sacramento needs Southern California, and Southern California needs Sacramento. This thing about the revival is not there. No, the revival is not here. No, the revival is in us.
Amen.
Within us. It's the kingdom of God that needs to be manifested, that needs to be expressed. And the second part of the word was, we need to live supernaturally. Do you guys live supernaturally? Meaning, we had a blind man see yesterday. No, Friday. Yes. His eyes opened. He couldn't speak. And started saying words. By the way, he said, Mama. I'm like, I'm not your mama. Because I'm not sure if you're the first thing you see. But, okay? I'm serious. I mean, he was like, Mama. I'm like, okay. Where's his mom? He was 53 years old. Had not spoken or seen. I have a bucket list, and the ladies joke with me. I want to raise the dead it, I can do it. So don't look at me funny. We should be able to do it. We should have enough anointing within us that we are able to go to the homeless. What is it you want? And give them the healing they need. Where is the pain? Gone.
Amen.
Okay? Now, are we there yet? You know, we're going to go to the crusade to get the healing. No. The Lord showed me this year has to be a supernatural year. And you know, for us all people, we're a little slower and dense. We know the word very well. But I've seen the young people do miracles. The little guys. The younger generation doesn't have difficulty experiencing the supernatural. The problem is, since they haven't had any guidance, they end up in the demonic, in the satanic, in the Wiccan. They end up, now there's a new video game, the seer. Don't you think the devil, it asks them to close their eyes and be guide their visions. Now what do you think is going to come out of that one? Now the devil is ahead of us. Why don't we teach our children how to have visions from heaven? That they don't need the video game. So, you know, I go in my soapbox at this moment. But that generation can do it. But they don't have a foundation of the word like we do. We have a lot of work. We're really fat. No experiences. So can we come together? That's another part of the word. We need to unite the generation. God is the God of generations. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They didn't send them to college at 18 and ask them to get a job. That's not biblical. Nothing against college. But the thing is, we send our kids out there in a dorm with a bunch of people that we don't know who they are. And we have no idea what happens. And then we want to know why they have problems. We have sent our children, our nation, the Lord, I truly believe this with all my heart. I think the Lord has made the job market really tough. So our children have to come home because they don't have money. Really, my kids live with me. I go to college with them. Okay, I do, both my kids. The tiny, tiny little corner like this. It's what God is doing. He's bringing your children back to you, those that have children. And by the way, if you don't have kids, there are spiritual kids there that need a mom. They need a dad. They need somebody that can tell them, Jesus is amazing. Jesus is good. Jesus can help you. He can make you free. And live a supernatural life. So, I'm saying all this to say, you guys have an amazing region. This region is amazing, amazing. But again, I said, I do spiritual mapping. Minerva is a big, big item, ticket item. That doesn't stop God. And when I ask the Lord about strategies of war, He has never told me to go against her. She's all over the state. She's all over. She's in your social security checks. She's in the cop's badge. She's everywhere. She's in the Capitol. There's a statue of her everywhere. She's everywhere. Someone marked our state, our seal has her on it. Okay? But the Lord told me, this is the season to put our feet on her head and go up. Amen. We gotta go higher, higher, above the principalities. If we're here kicking and screaming, there's a demon here, there's a demon here, there's a demon here. We are demon focused. Okay, sometimes as intercessors, I'm guilty. We spend all day identifying how many demons are in the house. And what God has told me is, you have no idea who I am. And then the fear of God came over me. And He has shown me that in order for us to be victorious in this state, we have to have access to the courts of heaven. And in order to do that, you must understand what's in the courts. The Bible says in Ephesians 6, there are principalities and powers and authorities in heavenly places. If you don't take your throne with Jesus, we are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You know what that means? You're in it. Not in His lap. No, you're in it with Him, one. If you don't take that position, the devil will take it. There are authorities in heavenly places, and I know theological I could be stoned, but what I'm saying is, if we don't step into it and move in, it's a season of access. It's a season to take what the enemy has stolen from us, what he's robbed from us, and replace it. Now, we need to replace them. We are going to go and say, I'm done with this. I want my stuff.
Yes.
We want our state back. Yes. And by the way, in June, California will vote. And most likely, we will determine the elections. I could predict that probably. We will decide what's going to happen or something. We always do. You know how many delegates we have? Oh, my goodness. So please, please. If you have a passion for this state, if you don't like it, that's fine. But if the Lord is saying, we must be the people of God in this state for the sake not just of Sacramento, not just of California, the rest of the nation, but I do believe the rest of the world. So all we need is a few people that are willing to live supernaturally. And in order to do that, sometimes we have to lay down a lot of things. Sometimes we have to lay down our practices. And we need to seek him desperately to be able to rule in the courts. So with that, Gil, yes.
Okay, sir. What I'd like to do is what we have here are a lot of leaders. Go ahead and keep the mic. But I'm going to have Aaron go ahead and come up and do some music. And I'd like it if the Lord will download for you, that you would begin to just prophetically move into worship. But I'd like you to
We're going to blow. Okay. Does that make sense? I just need to stir people. I'm one person. It doesn't matter. I just want my state back. Yeah. I want my state back. Yeah. I know Lou probably cried out to God like a desperate man. I want my state back. I want my nation back. Yes. I want my children. I may not be here. I may never see it. But my children and my grandchildren to have what God promised us. That doesn't mean it's all going to be pretty. I'm not talking pretty pink glasses. We know end times are not pretty, and I think we are in end times. But it means, are you in your position? There is a scroll written for each one of you. What is your assignment in this earth?
Amen.
This theology of going to heaven, we're going to go to heaven, we're not going to heaven anyways. Good. We all here, I assume you all have Christ, if you don't raise your hands. But there is something written that only you can do. No one else can do it. No one else can do it. So, if you're not doing what the scroll says, I don't know. I don't know what happens, you know? So, there is an assignment for each individual here. There are things that the Lord has that needs done, and he's chosen to collaborate with us. And the way we're going to get our state back is if we stay in our position. So if that means looking like a crazy lady standing here with a mic, I'm going to do it. Because I want my state back. I want my state back. I want my kids to live supernatural lives. I want my kids to raise the dead but not practice with me because I want to be with Jesus. Get it? So, I want to ask you guys, don't expect me. I'm a human. We have access to the heavens. So the worship team can take us there. Whatever it takes, brother, go back. And then we need to be able to go higher with the Lord. Higher. If you have anything hindering you from going higher, we got to take care of business. You need to go to the next level to be able to hear and not hear. Jesus saw his Father do. We need to be able to see heaven. We need to be able to see what the Lord is doing. What is he doing for the state? What does he want us to do in Sacramento? Does he want Janine to go to the Capitol and scream like a crazy? businessmen.
Thank you.
to do with your voice. Release the voice, Lord. Do you sing? No? Okay. You do a lot of speaking. Okay, there's something like that. Okay, so today, Lord, you're showing me her mouth, whatever it is. You take her mouth, you put a cold in her mouth, and here I am, send me. Here I am, send me. You're going to do things with your husband, but I see him pulling you separate for this project. There's something that it's only you, that doesn't mean you will leave the husband. That means you are, is your project, is your thing, it's your thing. Now you have your wing over here protecting you all the time, but this thing must be done. And God is calling you in the privacy of your heart, right here, saying, come to me, it's you and I. And you're going to do this thing that's just yours, and you will use your mouth. So today we release her, Lord. We thank you, Lord. And we ask you to take that mouth and multiply it 100-fold. Multiply it 100-fold. Multiply her 100-fold. You bless them both, Lord. Multiply. We need more of this. More of this. More, 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 more. More business, more business, more business, more business, more business, more business. Creativity for new businesses, new ideas, and the Lord says, Gary, to hear my wisdom, you're going to have to lay down a few things, you have to lay down a few things, be obedient, hear me, hear me, hear me, I have many, many things, amazing things for you to perform for me. You're the only one who has the mind and the hands to do it. But you must lay down a few things. He'll show you. Hakakabasha. O Karana Maria Mamasha Tatia Ramaka. Oh, lovebirds. The lovebirds. The lovebirds. The lovebirds. I love to touch bread, but it doesn't mean anything. I need to see your tattoos. I need to see your tattoos. I need to see your tattoos. I. So I'm gonna pray over you guys as a band, as a team, and Franklin and them, they're part of it. You bless them, Lord, so that they can bring this church to a new level of the sounds of heaven. I release the sound of heaven, sound of heaven, sound of heaven.
Break and release.
job. You know how amazing you are. And may these people live in the courts of heaven in supernatural places, accessing things they never thought they would access. Give them access, free access. May they rule your courts properly. May they rule your courts properly. May they rule your courts properly.